Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hill of Beans, a novel of war and celluloid, by Leslie Epstein. Narrated by Charles Constant. Voiceover. With the coming of the Second World War, many eyes in imprisoned Europe turned hopefully or desperately toward the freedom of the Americas. This is the story of how one nation, one industry, and in particular one man, responded to that desperation and that hope. Preview. It happens in the movies. Hedda Hopper's Hollywood, December 1941, Los Angeles. Since Hedy Lamarr has taken off those silks and satins and gotten into something that shows her chassis, she's certainly the life of the party in Tortilla Flat with Tracy and John Garfield so hot after her, it's enough to turn any girl's head. I mean, for the picture, dearie, don't go getting ideas. Going to hotfoot it over to Union Station tomorrow morning to meet the super chief when the Ferrer's Warner's newest acquisition, German starlet Carolina Kaiser, arrives from Berlin. This 19-year-old blonde isn't well known over here, but she's featured in many ingenue roles and is quite a heartthrob in theaters across Europe. Search me why such a rising young actress would want to leave Germany, which is making so many exciting pictures these days. Rumor has it that Warner Brothers, and Jack Warner in particular, were kind to her after the tragic accident that took the life of her father, a low-level studio employee. Whatever the reason, we're always happy to have such pretty young talent. Welcome to America, Fräulein Kaiser. Spent yesterday afternoon Christmas shopping at Bullock's Wilshire with Rita Hayworth, who has made such a hit in Strawberry Blonde. Christmas, I declared to this sultry Spaniard. Why, today is only the 5th. Christmas is 3 weeks away. That's true, Hedda, she told me. But I have so many new friends and fans, I've got to start early. That red hair looks like the real thing to yours truly. With censorship rearing up again, I hear that 20th will drape those nude Greek statues in Tales of Manhattan with plaster sarongs. Incidentally, in that one, Charles Boyer has 3 death scenes and comes out alive. Yes, it happens in the movies. Part 1. To the Garden. 1. Salute, goddammit. The Terrible Turk, April 1942, Burbank. The sons of the prophet are brave men and bold, and never a danger will shirk. But the bravest by far in the ranks of the Shah was Abdul the Terrible Turk. That's me. Maybe not so terrible now, but I can still outbox any man on the lot, including the illustrious Errol Leslie Flynn. He wants to fight. In the army, I mean. Or the navy. Anywhere. But he's got a heart problem. 4F. Julius Epstein, one of those writer twins, was a bantamweight intercollegiate champ. He's 30 years younger, but I've got 60 pounds on him. The idea is that I take on him and his brother. We're trying to arrange it. It'll be a fair fight, all for the war effort and the good of the country. The sons of the prophet and so forth and so on. That's what we shouted through the megaphone before every bout. My biggest was with Philadelphia Jack O'Brien. 2-22-07. I remember the dates of all my fights, especially that one. He was still the light heavyweight champion. Ring ranks him number 2 in the history of the world. I won 5 rounds. My whole life would have been different. But we had to throw in the Turkish towel. Ho-ho, some joke. My next biggest was when I was for a short time in the business doing silence for First National, and even a feature called One Round Hogan, in which I played a guy named Sniffy and got KO'd by Jimmy Jeffries, who played himself. It was a real concussion caused by the ring pole, and they had to shoot around me for 2 days. The chief, but I didn't call him anything but Mr. Warner then, was mad as hell. You're seeing double. So what if you're seeing double? I'm seeing red. Red ink. That was the end of my motion picture career. It was also the beginning of my relationship with the chief. Yesterday he wanted me to meet at wardrobe. I thought he wanted to outfit his latest blonde, whose name is Carolina Kaiser, not the one the chief gave her, and not Miss Kaufman, which is the one she was born with. She's a beauty, all right, even though she hasn't got what you'd call an hourglass figure. Not much sand in the top. I can't help feeling sorry for her, being a refugee, and all of her family, I hear, or maybe only her father, was shot. I wouldn't mind getting that Hitler in the ring. He'd be KO number 4. Anyhow, when I got over to the wardrobe department, I was surprised to find out they weren't making a costume for the girl, but were putting the pins and the chalk on the chief. "Hello, Abdul," said this, no joke here, knockout. "Good afternoon, miss," I said, because I was embarrassed to call her by her first name, which is Karolina. I took the hand she held out to me, wondering for a second whether because she was from the continent of Europe I was supposed to bow down and kiss it. Instead, I said, "Is that the outfit they made for you? For when you test for Ilsa?" "It's A-okay with me. Thumbs up." It was a nice dress with a zigzag pattern and little puffs at the sleeves. She laughed.
"Oh, this is off the May Company rack. The fitting today is for Mr. Warner."
Then, right on cue, from behind a curtain stepped the chief, dressed in what I found out was a U.S. Army Air Force uniform. He held up his arms and grinned, like a girl coming out of a cake, and his teeth were brighter than the brass buttons that ran up the front of his tunic. "Don't just stand there, dummy," he said, pointing at the silver oak leaves on his shoulders. "You better learn how to salute." "You bet, chief," I said, and put my thumb to my eyebrow, like in the movies. "You bet, colonel," said J.L., and he wasn't kidding. "Colonel," I said, and saluted all over again. "Lieutenant Colonel, actually." Then Rido Loshak stepped through the curtain, I swear to God, with the points of pins in his mouth. "You too," said the chief, giving him a nod. And when a wardrobe girl came out with the chief's old suit over her arm, he said more or less to all of us, "What's the matter with you people? Don't you know there's a war on? Salute, goddammit! Salute!"
2. Gloria Palast. Goebbels, last day of April 1945, Berlin. Our last hope, Monke, arrived an hour ago with the latest reports. Some good news. The Schlesische station has been recaptured. A brief celebration. Then bad news. The Russians have taken the Friedrichstrasse tunnel and have moved into Vostrasse, only a stone's throw away. The Führer heard these words without emotion. He had already received more important intelligence from Professor Hase, who informed him that when, with a pair of pliers, he crushed an ampule of prussic acid in Blondie's mouth, the dog died on the instant without a whimper of pain. That is the only news worth celebrating. Magda has arranged to get a supplier from Stumpfeger. Not for ourselves, for the children. For tomorrow night. How they liked to romp about with that bitch's puppy. He would nip with his sharp little teeth, but never do any real damage. And after? Nothing of the Führer must be allowed to remain. I have ordered Gunsche and Kempke to bring 200 liters of petrol to the garden. We saw what had happened to the Duce. Hung by the heels, mocked and desecrated by the masses, the Führer is determined that he shall not suffer such a fate. To be forced to act in a farce, one in which the Bolsheviks can have a good laugh, and the Jews with their hacked-off schwenge can urinate on him through the bars of his cage. Linge has confirmed that a minimum of 180 liters has been secured. They shall have to find more for Magda and myself. Schwegemann will see to it. The Führer has now completed his luncheon, a modest and calm last meal, differing in no respect from so many others, that is, with only Frau Trudel and Frau Christian, and Fräulein Manserli for company. There is true humility. A knock on the door. Bormann. His criminal face is without expression. The head of the Parteikanzlei. The Führer has summoned you and Frau Goebbels to say Auf Wiedersehen. I try to hide my annoyance. What need of this ceremony? I said my own goodbyes when I witnessed the Führer's last testament and, with flowing tears, added my own coda to it. A vow never to abandon him in his hour of greatest need. Still, I rise from my chair. Bormann turns. I follow him. The farewell. Better to have remained in my den. The Führer stooped and wan. Eva, now Frau Hitler, in a blue, white-trimmed dress. A handshake, weak, moist, and a word or two. My dear Goebbels. And the rest an inaudible mumble. Bergdorf steps up next. And after him, Krebs. Suddenly, strangely, from another time, from another planet, it seems, these wild words come to me. Baby, what are you out for? Baby, what am I in for? In English. American English. Sung by Negger. Written by Jews. At last, the Führer moves away. His arm, held behind his back, is shaking. Magda pulls at my sleeve. She tells me she is going to Gönscha and ask to be admitted to the Führer's study. She intends to make a final plea, that he abandon the bunker, abandon Berlin, and lead the resistance from Bavaria. It is all I can do not to laugh in her face. I doubt he will even agree to hear her. Baby, what am I in for? The jungle music. I know where it comes from. A film. Typical pablum from the Jew Warner, born Vonskolasser. 20 million sweethearts. How bright and gay Charlottenburg on the night of that premiere. The Kurfürstendamm, gleaming with the headlights and taillights of taxis and sedans. The shower of sparks and the number 6 trolley. All gone. All burned to the ground. Nothing but swaying walls and debris. The black smoke rising into the black sky. Our German folk running through the streets like ghosts. Is my baby out for no good? A single stone was dropped that night. On the Kurfürstendamm. Kaufmann. The Jew, Kaufmann. And the daughter, Karolina. She might have changed everything. She almost saved everything. Instead, the ripples that should have carried us to the triumph of National Socialism became the wave that has overwhelmed us. Our Reich. Our beautiful Berlin. July 1934, Berlin. Dinner alone at the Ordenspalais, and then the premiere at the Gloria Palast. I arrived 10 minutes late and with my hat pulled low, lest one in that crowd of more than 1,000 recognize me. I take the spot that has been reserved, off to one side of the balcony. On the screen, the American actor Powell is making a clown of himself as he sings for all the capitalists of the radio network his beer hall ballad, "Oh, he floats through the air with the greatest of ease." I have, of course, seen this production before, just as I have viewed every film before approving it for our masses. I am aware that when Herr Paul sings his ballads to Fräulein Rogers, each of the women in his broadcast audience, those 20 million sweethearts, will believe that she and she alone is the one he loves. Our own audience of good Germans is no better. I hear them all around me, laughing and clapping and cheering for this yodeling buffoon. I can't wait until, like well-trained circus Seehunde, they pull out their handkerchiefs as this dick turns to this ginger with the words, "All my life I've waited for an angel, but no angel ever came along." Our sobbing, weeping, sentimental folk, just like these Americans sighing over their Philcos, their Crossleys, and their ugly wooden zeniths. I shall make certain that soon there will be no such empty-headed radio listeners in the Reich. Rather, they will all be listening to what I want them to hear. 20 million sweethearts. I intend to guarantee that 80 million Germans fall no less deeply in love. What do the latest Volksempfänger cost? Fewer than 40 Reichsmarks. I am determined that every home in the nation shall possess one. No, not one, 2, 3. A receiver in every room. And each will be turned to a single station. The Deutschlandsender. And on this station there will be a soul voice, repeating over and over, in one guise or another, the same message. Ein Volk, ein Reich, ein Führer. Now, in the Gloria Palast, the time has come to act.
With both hands, I raise my hat from my head, as if the pressure from such pondering had made my skull swell inside it. Still too tight, I raise it again to make sure the Dummköpfe have seen it. Then I stand and move toward the nearest exit. I pause, not looking at the screen, but waiting to hear the words I know will come from the loudspeakers behind it. Dick Powell, at the microphone, utters them aloud. "And now, ladies and gentlemen, I have a real surprise for you. Yes, sir, I'm afraid you guessed it. It's the Mills Brothers." At once, the four Schwarzeneggers burst into song. "Baby, what are you out for? Baby, what am I in for? Is my baby out for no good?" "Alles Afrikaner raus!" shouts a voice from somewhere down in the orchestra. "Away with these negger!" Another voice, closer by in the balcony, cries, "They are insulting the Aryan race!" Some in the audience make shushing noises. A voice declares, "We want to hear the music." "Music? A German calls this music?" That is the fellow in the balcony. "Just listen. It is the sound of the zoo." As if following those instructions, everyone does seem to listen. Impossible to translate into German how the black men in their dark jackets and cream-colored pants turn the lyrics of the song into chaos. "Rooty a tooty a poop droop a doop." "Ha ha ha," a second man joins the first in the balcony. "Monkeys have learned to talk. It is the love song of the apes. 9, the Parliament of Africa." Now at the front of the orchestra, a small formation of SA marches before the first row of seats. Together they point up toward the far-off projectionist's window. "The filth must stop. Turn off the machine." For a moment, nothing occurs. The primitive rhythms continue while our Berliners watch and listen from their plush Gloria Palast seats. At last, one of our men in the balcony rushes forward and throws something that, trailing a stream of smoke, flies into the midst of the sitting crowd. A second man races ahead and hurls a similar missile. In seconds, the smell of sulfur, accompanied by alarming sparks, spreads through the theater. Now people begin to stand. They push by the ones who remain stubbornly seated. Suddenly, a loud crash at the back of the room and the yellow beam in which have danced so many Warner Brothers dollars goes out. Simultaneously, the house lights come on to reveal, at the front of the theater, a group of men wearing something resembling lab coats. Each carries a wire cage, the front latch of which he kneels down to open. The SA men are happy to offer an explanation. "Here you are, ladies, your favorite entertainers, the 400 Mouse Brothers." Immediately, scores, perhaps there really are 400 in all, of white mice begin to run into the crowded auditorium. At the same time, the house lights once more go out. In the pitch dark, all is pandemonium. Women scream, men curse. Fist fights break out as people climb over each other to reach the aisles. Suddenly, unmistakably, a single shot rings out. It seems to cause everyone to take in his breath. Then all the doors, with a brown shirt to either side, are flung open. The crowd streams out, some into the lobby, some directly into the street. In less than 3 minutes, the great hall stands empty. Only one patron remains in his seat. When the house lights come back on, he is found slumped forward, the result of the bullet that has gone into one side of his head and out the other. April 1945, Berlin. Magda enters without a knock. I see that she has been crying. "The Führer would not admit you?" She shook her head. "He admitted me. It was as if he were not there. As if he were pleading with the wall, or begging a piece of furniture. You would be ashamed of me." I broke into tears. "I am not ashamed, but I warned you. Now we must find our dentist." "We have time. Tonight, a normal sleep. Tomorrow night, nothing must wake them. Not the loudest explosion."
"Send someone to the Chancellery. Alert him to come as soon as he can."
"And Stumpfegger."
"Yes, Stumpfegger.
Tell him to bring
He will know what to bring. And cigarettes. Cigarettes! The condemned man wants his last pleasure.
I wave her away. First the dentist, then Stumpfegger. Make sure they get here in time. August 1934, Berlin. My presumption that the dead man in the Gloria Palast committed suicide was soon confirmed. For this, we must thank the timely report from our Staatspolizei. Name, Josef Kaufmann, an American Jew. Geboren in Cincinnati, a leading city of the state of Ohio. Some will undoubtedly exploit this incident and blame the death on the SA or the Gestapo, but it was an undoubted Selbstmord. The fatal wound to the left temple was delivered by a short-barreled Mauser C-96 military pistol. That pistol had been purchased by Herr Kaufmann after he had received a number of threats by telephone and the post. The weapon was found under the seat directly in front of the victim, who was, according to the testimony of his spouse, Frau Hannelore Kaufmann, of full-blooded Aryan descent, left-handed. After a diligent search, the coroner was able to recover the bullet, a 9mm parabellum round, from the plush material in a seat some 11 meters distant. Ballistic studies determined that it came from the victim's pistol. From the evidence of papers inside the jacket pocket of the deceased, it seems that the Jew was despondent at being unable to find employment in the new Germany. The inevitable conclusion of the coroner was that the fatal wound to Herr Josef Kaufmann had been self-inflicted. He leaves, in addition to Frau Kaufmann, a daughter, Karolina, age 12, Mischling of the first degree. One question still remained before us. How would the Americans, and in particular Warner Brothers, respond to the death of their citizen and their employee? Would we be accused? The coroner's report noted that Kaufmann could no longer find work. For that, we could indeed take the blame. Or, as those in my ministry prefer to see it, the credit. We demanded that all six American film companies dismiss every Jew on their payrolls. They quickly complied. For some time, the Americans made no response at all. You would have thought the poor fellow had never existed. But a few days ago, a dispatch arrived from Güssling, our consul in the city of Los Angeles. In it was a clipping from the publication that likes to call itself the Bible of the showbiz industry. It read as follows. Variety, July 24, 1934. WB to exit Germany. Acts after general manager killed in theater. By Bernard Katz. Studio chief Jack L. Warner announced yesterday that he was closing all Warner Brothers offices and exchanges in Berlin and throughout Germany. He said this action was in direct response to what he claimed was the murder of his Berlin branch manager Joe Kaufmann by Nazi toughs. The six majors have been under pressure in Hitlerland since they were required to dismiss their non-Aryan personnel. Over the course of the last year, each studio began replacing its Jewish representatives with Christian employees. The feeling here was that the Jew problem had been trumped up for popular consumption and would soon blow over. How wrong that assessment turned out to be was revealed when Kaufmann was shot to death at the UFA Gloria Palast while tracking audience responses to his studio's 20 Million Sweethearts radio comedy with Powell and Rogers and foreign grosses of 1.2 million. He died with his boots on, Warner declared at yesterday's press conference, working loyally for his studio until the very end. The exec went on to explain that he had urged Kaufmann to transfer to a similar position in Poland or Czechoslovakia, or even to return to a new post in Burbank. But Joe had come to love both Germany and its people. He married a fine German woman. They had a lovely daughter. Over the last few months, the Nazis burnt his car, trashed his flat, and attacked him with vicious dogs in a back alley. They forced the 12-year-old Karolina out of her school. Still, he believed these thugs did not represent the true Germany and that he was not going to let them hound him out of what had become his own country. Now I wish that instead of sticking by him, we had been wise enough to insist. We made our own investigation. A gang of brown shirts made a big fuss in the theater. When everyone was distracted, they hunted Joe down in the dark. They snuck up behind him and shot him in the head. Warner Brothers is no longer doing business in the German market.
I don't care what it costs us, and it costs us plenty. No one at Para, MGM, Universal, Fox, or Columbia would comment on the Kaufman case, though the marketing execs made it clear that none of their studios was considering closing down its German operation at this time. A spokesman for Disney, reached by phone, said, "Withdraw from Germany? Why? They're a dynamic country, a friend to the United States, and they appreciate our product more than anyone else. Disney isn't going anywhere." The foreign market makes up more than half of all studio revenues, and in that market no other country save Britain can come close to matching German grosses. Gisling offered the opinion that the other five studios will not follow suit, and that Herr Warner is a hothead acting entirely on his own. He underlined the statement by Herr Disney, who has been sympathetic to our cause, and said it more closely reflects the opinion of the studio magnates, even those of Jewish blood, than that of Herr Wonksolasser. "I think we have little to fear. And in any case, once our own industry produces work worthy of the National Socialist spirit, we shall send them packing, whether they wish to leave or not." Last day of April, 1945, Berlin. What was that? A shot? Yes. Far off, muffled, but a definite report. Will there be another? Why isn't there another? The Führer. Undoubtedly dead. Or is it, still difficult to say this word, Frau Hitler? Did one or the other lose courage? I refuse to believe it. But where is the second shot? August 1934, Berlin. Gisling was correct. Warner is a hothead. But in addition, there is no measuring the depths of his hypocrisy. I could learn lessons in effrontery, in absolute insouciance, from this master. I have not forgotten the documents found inside the victim's pockets. Some were nothing more than scraps of paper. For instance, an old receipt marked Zylinderhut Billard, which is evidently a pool hall establishment. Also, a half page torn from the Berlin Tageblatt that contained most of the city's motion picture theaters and the times of the main features. Some were circled in black ink, including that night's premiere at the Gloria Palast. Of greater interest, however, were two letters, one long and one short. The first was written in the dead man's own hand, and obviously never posted. It is addressed to Wonksolasser in Burbank, California. Of course, after making a copy, we returned the original to the widow. July 3, 1934. J.L. I just received your most recent letter, written on May 31st. The one-month delay was probably caused by the censors. God knows when this one will get to you for the same reason. Nowadays, they examine every word. I guess all I really want to say was how disappointed I was to finally read your reply once it arrived. I haven't drawn a paycheck since last September, when the studio let me go. You had no choice, no hard feelings. You know that I still came to the office anyway, and right at 9 a.m., by the way. I didn't want people to think the studio had caved into Goebbels and the rest of that crowd. That was as important to me as I know it is for you. But since May, there has been a guard at the door and a cop on the street. I can't get anywhere near the place. I have no other paying job. Things are getting pretty rough. Last week, Hannelore was forced out of the auction house. Blonde hair, blue eyes, spotless bloodlines. Not good enough. I don't have to tell you the reason. Carolina is not going to be allowed to return to school at the end of the summer break. I am not so sure the Jewish schools are going to hold out open arms. They've got their bloodlines, too. What is to become of her? 12 years old. Back to business. Saw fashions of 1934 at the UFA Palast. You've got a big hit on your hands. There must have been 2,000 people laughing their heads off. The key to the success of this picture, and just about every other Warner's feature, is the Berkeley routines. They are a big hit with Herr Hitler as well. I have heard from reputable sources that he still watches 42nd Street 4 or 5 times a week, sometimes twice in a row. Predicted gross, 250,000. J.L., you've got no idea of what's going on here. If you have a Jew in the family, no matter how distant,
It's a stain. You can't wash it away. Imagine if you've got a Jew for a father, a Jew for a spouse. It's curtains. I've got to figure it out. At this time, we have nothing for you in our offices abroad. You didn't write those words. You didn't mean them. We go back too far. Didn't I get you into Germany in the first place? With Where the North Begins? The Wolf Dog. I'm the one who shepherded Rin Tin Tin from one city to another. The Germans loved it. And besides, it's not true. Not true. I know there is an opening in Warsaw. I know it for a fact. No. No, of course you wrote those words, J.L. I'm the one who didn't mean what I just wrote. If this were in pencil, I'd erase it. I'd rub it out. I apologize. Back to business. But I already said that. The long and the short of it is, you can save yourself a lot of time and trouble by not submitting the Robinson picture. The man with two faces? They hate them both. That's because he speaks out. He takes stands. Do yourself a favor. Tell him and everybody else to put a sock in it. They cost you and they cost the studio. But can you just stop and think how much they are costing me? For God's sake, J.L., put yourself in possession of the facts. I'd just like to say that it is my wish that my friend Alex Engelsing take care of my daughter in case anything happens to me. He is her Uncle Engel. Time and trouble. That's not all my advice has saved you. What about the money? A ton of money. That's how much my connections are worth. 10 years of connections. I know what's going on at the Reichsfilmkammer. People still talk to me. They like me. Nobody turns their back. I think there has been a misunderstanding. I wasn't angling to become the branch manager in Poland. Maybe I didn't express myself clearly. I'll take any position. A rental agent in Prague or sales rep in Stockholm. Bring me back to Burbank. I'll sweep the floor of the writer's bungalow. You can't get any lower than that, right, J.L.? I'll be the guy who keeps an eye out, to make sure those guys come in at 9. You'll be able to meet my family. Hannalora is learning English, bit by bit. I guarantee she'll be fluent by the time we arrive on the coast. And Karolina, blonde, like her mother. Not from me. Eyes blue, blue-gray. Also not from me. You would never guess she has a drop of Jewish blood. You should see her nose. Straight, I swear. Like on a Greek statue. Like on an ancient coin. She speaks English with hardly an accent. She's got a broad brow stuffed full of brains. Now they won't even let her play billiards. J.L., you'd never know she's my daughter. You would never know I injected her with poison. Jack, Jesus, they set the dogs on me. Well, back to the grindstone. Tonight I'm going to the premiere of 20 Million Sweethearts. It's at the Gloria Palast on Kurfürstendamm. I'll hold on to this letter until tomorrow so that I can add my impressions. There's not a single Jew in the cast. I don't think there's going to be any trouble. So long for now. And don't worry, I'm paying for my own ticket. Your friend, Joe. This is the second letter in the dead man's pocket, written 1 month before the first. Date, May 31, 1934. Subject, Kaufman Employment. To Mr. Kaufman, from Jack L. Warner. Dear Joe Kaufman, I am in receipt of your letters of April 4th, April 18th, April 27th, May 3rd, and May 22nd. I am sorry to have to tell you that at this time we have nothing for you in our offices abroad. Where did you get the idea that we had any openings? I have noted your reports on gold diggers of 1933, 42nd Street, and the other pictures. In future, if you have information for us, please send it directly to Blank or Sam Bischoff. Regards to your family, J.L. Warner. I am in possession of one last letter written just a few days ago. We intercepted it, as we do all letters sent out of the Reich, copied it for our files, and then mailed it off to the recipient. 24 August, 1934. Sehr geehrter Herr Mr. Jack L. Warner. Here is the correspondence of my husband. He intended the next day to send it to you by the mail. It is called, I think, in English language, a suicide note.
Hannelore Kaiser, for Herr Frau Josef Kaufmann. Last day of April, 1945, Berlin.
Again, Magda. This summons I cannot ignore. I follow her to the Führer's study.
Gunscher stands guard, with Linger and Bormann. I motion to Linger, who opens the door.
The smell of almonds, bitter and sharp, is in the air. Eva and the Führer are both on the sofa. He has a bullet wound in the temple. She has swallowed the poison. The last of his women to take their own lives.
Everything now occurs swiftly. The Führer is wrapped in a blanket, and he and his spouse are carried up the four flights to the garden. The shells from the Bolsheviks are falling near. Some have already landed in the grounds. Both bodies are doused with petrol. A shell lands to the left. A second one follows. I offer my matches. The wind, or is it the concussions from the falling bombs, blows them out.
Linger twists some papers together, which Bormann makes into a sort of torch. He throws it onto the bodies. They ignite with a rush.
Another shell. We retreat to the bunker door. There Krebs, Bergdorf, Bormann, Gunsche, Linger, and I give the salute. Without a word, we turn, bumping into each other in our haste to get inside. The heavy door closes behind us.
Is my baby out for no good?
After so many years, are these the words that are going to sound and sound and sound in my ears? They are louder than the thunder of the Russian guns. At least I will not have to bear them much longer. Weeks? Days? No. One more day at the most.
Fräulein Kaufmann, 1935, Berlin.
I knew Jojo worked for Mr. Warner because he took me to all the Warner Brothers pictures, even when there was school the next day. He once took me every night of the week, which made Hannelore, which made Mama, angry. I saw Gold Diggers of 1933. I was the girl in the window when Dick Powell sang, "In the shadows let me come and sing to you. Let me dream a song that I can bring to you." I was the one he blew the kiss to. Not that Ruby Keeler. Oh, I was so jealous of that person. I already had a crush on Dick because of 42nd Street. After Jojo took me to that, I snuck away from school and saw it three more times on my own. The way he held her in his arms. The best was Footlight Parade, when Dick and Ruby sing "By a Waterfall" together. What a moment that was. All those beautiful girls sliding into the water, swimming with their legs underneath and making a diamond necklace, that's what it looked like to me, on the surface. Shining, shining and glittering, like the pieces in Ein Kaleidoscope.
By a waterfall, I'm calling you, ooh, ooh, ooh.
Then he kissed her, on the screen. But it was my own lips that were open and hot. Oh, if Jojo knew what I was feeling. It wasn't all romance. We saw Dracula. We saw M. We saw the horrible Dr. X, where the murderer always laid his corpses under a full moon. Oh, the chunks taken out of their bodies. Cannibalismus. I was only 10 years old. I wanted to run, to run, to run. Jojo put his hands over my eyes, and we stayed in our seats. But I had nightmares. Night after night. It was my throat the fangs of the vampire sank into. I took the balloon from the hands of the whistling murder. I saw my body, my girl's body, lying in the moonlight. Jojo, Papa, would come into my room. He would take the two ends of my bedsheet and hold them above me. And he would say, "You see, no one can harm you." And he would flap the sheet back and forth. "With these wings you can fly away." But I didn't believe him. Why didn't he fly away when they beat him? He just lay there in the street. So I knew I couldn't fly away, not from the moon killer. In 20 Million Sweethearts, Dick wasn't the juvenile lead. He was the star. I could tell from his picture in the newspaper. It was summer. I wasn't in school. I begged Jojo to take me to the Gloria Palast. It's Dick Powell. But he said no. I couldn't understand. He never said no. I lost my head. I told him he was a terrible father. It didn't do any good. Then I told him, I'll drown myself. I'll put my head in the oven. That didn't do any good either. He smiled. He said, tomorrow we'll play pool together. It doesn't matter about the Zylinderhut. We'll find a new place, you and me. You'll like that, won't you? He knew that I would. I even had my own cue stick with my initials, KK, on it. But I said I wouldn't. I said I wanted to go to the Gloria Palast. I wanted to go that night, that moment, now. But he turned and left me. It wasn't until the next day that I found out why.
3. Magic Hands. The Terrible Turk, November 1941, Washington, D.C. I have been to the White House a lot since the president took office, and I think I'll be invited again. I like going. Everybody takes your coat and your hat. Mostly I go alone, but a few times I've gone with the chief. Only I don't call him that because that's really the president's job, head of the army and the navy and the whole country, and not just the Burbank studio. Instead, when I have something to say, I just go, "That's right, Mr. Warner." Or if the president asks about my pal Jack, I say, "Mr. Warner is fine." The president calls him Jack, and sometimes Jack, old boy. Or once, when we were all fishing together, good old Jacko. That happened when Mr. FDR and me were back in the stern together. He asked me to leave Warner Brothers and come to work for him. The chief must have heard him, because at that very moment he walked up holding this barracuda or some other fish he caught, and he was smiling the way he does, with all his teeth. He said, "What about it, Abdul? You want to work in the White House and drink old fashions?" The smile was because he knew I would say no. The president didn't give up. Another time he said, "Jack, old fellow, I'm going to make you ambassador to Norway and keep Abdul here for myself." But the chief figured he was kidding and just said, "Norway? I couldn't afford it." One time, though, he got real scared. We were going down a hallway, the president in that bicycle chair, when all of a sudden he stopped and looked up at the chief and said, "You know, Jack, about Abdul here, I might have to make this a matter of national security." And the chief, like he's in on the joke, said, I know, you're going to make me ambassador to Timbuktu, but I already told you, I look lousy in striped pants." But this was no joke. "You don't understand," the president said. "I need him. Don't you see I am in pain?" The chief did not say a word, which was, believe me, an unheard-of event, and I give thanks to God Mr. Roosevelt did not turn to me, because I had tears in my eyes, and in spite of the fact I love the chief and never want to leave him, I think I might have said, "Okay, I'll come." Maybe you have figured out that I am not a man of few words. The talkative Turk, some people have called me. I'm going to talk now about our last visit to the White House, which occurred only one day ago. We got to Pennsylvania Avenue and were disappointed, since we were told that the president was waiting for us over in the steam room, and that meant no martinis and no old fashions, which he always mixed for us himself and poured into silver glasses. He squeezed the oranges with one hand so we could be impressed by how strong his arms were, which was, as you can take it from an expert, plenty. Then the chief said, "You go, Abdul, and I'll wait up here and see the president later. Maybe somebody around here will take pity on a starving man and bring him a soda cracker. Between you and me, that is, for these Episcopalians, a feast." But right away Arthur, the president's right-hand man, and of course a colored, which was the race he had a fondness for, Arthur came up and said that the chief was supposed to come along too. This was a first. I knew the sight that awaited me, but the chief, well, I guess he had an imagination for it, because his face, which was as dark as mine because of the million years he spent playing tennis in the sun, all of a sudden was drained of its color, as if Mr. Roosevelt had squeezed it like one of those oranges or lemons.
"Sure," he answered Mr. Prettyman. "Lead on, Macduff."
The whole world knows that Franklin Roosevelt was a victim of the infantile, and most people did their best to forget it. Sometimes, because of his smiling with that cheerful cigarette and that chin, I thought Mr. FDR forgot it too. But not the terrible Turk. I should have said that Mr. Prettyman was the right leg man of the president, and the left leg man too, since it was his job to get him into those braces with the straps and then into his pants and his socks and his shoes. When we got to the steam room, which was really only one of the laundry rooms that had been fitted up with a bench and exercise rings, the braces were propped up against a wall. His suit of clothes was on a hanger. The president himself was face down on the rubbing table. You could see from his hair that he had been swimming in the pool. "Hello, Jack, old boy." This came out in a shout, or maybe the tiles on the walls made it sound like one. "Abdul, a sight for sore eyes." He waved his left hand at both of us. The chief made some lame joke, though maybe that is not in good taste to use that word right now, about the president being in the swim or doing swimmingly, and I just said, "Hello, Mr. President, I am glad to see you. Would you like me to begin?" "You bet," he answered, which came out also in a shout. "I've been looking forward to this day. No one has magic hands like you." An aide of some kind, he was wearing a Navy uniform, stood just inside the door. But it was Arthur Prettyman, the chief always called him the Roosevelt, who, the same as always, came to the table and folded the sheet up to the president's hips. It was, like I said, a sad sight. The chief was looking up at the ceiling or down at the floor and every which way, including whether all of a sudden he needed a manicure, except at where those twigs of legs lay on the table, all gray with blue veins and so thin that it was hard to believe there could be human bones inside them. "Pull up a chair, Jack," the president said, "and tell me what new picture you're going to send me for New Year's Eve." Three wicker chairs were lined up against the wall. The chief dragged one of them up to where he and Mr. Roosevelt were about eye to eye for their chat. "You saw a dive bomber, right? Wings to the wind, eyes to the skies. You saw Maltese Falcon, right? A masterpiece of mystery." "Indeed I did, and it was absolutely grand. I'm going to issue an executive order that you get the Academy Award. I only wish that Mr. Spade could work for the FBI. Between you and me and the wall over there, I wish he could be head of the FBI. No dice, Mr. President. We've got him under a 7-year contract." Mr. Roosevelt gave a big laugh. It was strange to see the difference between the pink and lively top of the man, his head, I mean, with his big shoulders, and the ice-cold sticks that I was rubbing for all I was worth, as if I could make them catch fire. "I want you to send me something before anyone else in the country gets to see it, so I can make them secrets of state. How about you're in the army now, a regiment of roars? Silvers and Durante get drafted into the army by mistake and try to make this stick-in-the-mud general trade in his horses for tanks. We were going to release it at Christmas, but I guess we can hold it for New Year's Day. Here's a kiss you don't want to miss, the longest in movie history. Send it along. I'll invite the chiefs of staff. They could use a lesson on modernization, not to mention kissing. 3 minutes plus 5 seconds. Reagan wanted to know how we got his wife to sit still for so long. Anything else in your treasure chest? What else have you got to cheer us up? Well, in January, we're releasing a picture about this guy, a real New York sophisticate who drops in on this Ohio family of rubes to have dinner. Well, what happens is he slips and breaks a hip or a leg or something and spends the whole winter making an ass of himself going around in his wheelchair. Oops. For a long time, maybe as long as that record kiss, nobody said a word. I was too embarrassed to speak myself. Then the president, his head was turned so I could see his smile, said, "What's the matter, Jack, old boy? You look a little peckish." See this for the chief. He was a master at changing the subject. "Remember when you were going to make me ambassador to Norway? Hitler got there first. What a diplomat. Now he's got ambassadors in Belgium and Holland and France. You'd better hurry up or you're going to run out of countries to send me to." The president did not laugh. He said, "As a matter of fact, Jack, that's why I asked you to come over here for my hour with Abdul." "Uh-oh. Where to now, Bangkok? I better go get a bow tie. Jack, I'm serious. I wanted to thank you, and Harry too, for re-releasing the Nazi spy picture. I've seen all the new scenes you added. Ripped from the headlines. A fat lot of good that did us. It's banned in half the countries in the world. Not the half that matters, Jack. When our citizens see German soldiers marching down the Champs-Élysées, they're going to make up their minds to stop them from marching down Broadway. Speaking of Broadway, we're doing the life of George M. Cohan, the Yankee Doodle dandiest entertainment of them all. It's plenty patriotic, and everybody sings Over There, and if you want to stir people up and get them in a fighting mood, that's your ticket. Wonderful, Jack. Just wonderful. Oh, there. Right there, Abdul. I feel it. I swear to you. Once more. And again. There's feeling at that spot.
The spot was on his right leg, just beneath the buttock. I dug in my thumb. The president gasped. He always said he could walk 10 feet farther after I'd gone to work on him. The trouble was, it didn't last. That's why I always had to come back. With a grunt, he said to the chief, "What I wanted to tell you, Jack, is that your pictures are performing a real service. They are going to hasten the day when this country makes up its mind to fight. That's why I wanted to see you, to offer my thanks."
"You don't have to give me a medal or anything. Well, maybe just a wee favor. Ask away, Jacko. If I can do it, I will."
The chief took an envelope from an inside pocket.
"It's personal, you know. It involves a very good friend of mine, now deceased. He worked for us in Berlin. He headed up our offices there. Joe Kaufman, as it so happens, of the Jewish persuasion. So when the Nazis came to power, they hunted him down. They cornered him in a theater and then shot him in the head."
"I am very sorry to hear that, Jack."
"Well, we paid the funeral expenses, naturally. We send money over to the family all the time."
"That's very good of you, old boy. You always do the right thing."
"Don't mention it. It's our policy to be loyal to our employees. Anyway, he had a daughter who a friend of his at Toby's, a guy that's now under contract with me, took under his wing. By the way, Paramount and those other studios are still doing business with those bums. At the time, the girl was only 12, but today she's 18 or 19, and she's had a few parts, and she's on the verge of being a star, whether she's half of a Jew or not."
"It sounds like the happy ending to one of your pictures."
"Far from it. It's more of a tearjerker. And with an old-fashioned villain, too. Goebbels. He's got his eye on her. More than an eye. Do I have to say more? She's desperate to get out, and we'd like to have her in Burbank. To tell the truth, she's a looker and we'll find work for her. Supposedly, she's got an ironclad contract with Toby's. I write and write and get no answer to my letters. And at the State Department, all we hear is no, no, no. They make it sound like there are a million people ahead of her. Every damned Jew left in Europe. So, until now, it's what in chess you call a stalemate."
"What they say is true, Jack. There probably are a million refugees. We can't let them all in. The country won't stand for it if they think we're going to fight a war for the Jews."
"Yeah, well, the thing is, we just got a letter from this Fräulein Kaiser. That's her screen name. I've got it right here. And with it came her old contract all torn up. So it seems she's free to come and those bums at Toby's don't want us to know. She wants to come. Isn't there some way to move her up to the top of the list?"
"I'd like to help, old boy, but I'm afraid I can't. You have to go through Secretary Hull. If he can't do anything, neither can I. You know the president doesn't do these kinds of favors for particular citizens."
"I know. I know. But it's a matter of life and death. If you'll just let me read you..." "Oh, dearie me."
What happened was that when the chief took the letter from the envelope, something slipped out and fell to the floor.
"See, Mr. President, here's the contract, just like I told you, with a big X through it and..."
"Just a minute, Jack. Didn't you notice you dropped something there?"
But Prettyman had already stepped over and picked up the piece of paper that had fallen through the chief's fingers. It wasn't paper, actually. It was a photograph.
"Aha," said the president, squinting through his little glasses. "What's this?"
This was the moment when, for the first time, I saw the face of Karolina Kaiser. It was a publicity shot.
lots of dramatic lighting and one shoulder bare. The eyebrows were dark, but the hair was blonde, and the lips of the mouth were like, well, in my opinion, like someone who was about to welcome a kiss. Right away, you could see why they wanted to make her a star. That combination of the girl and the woman, the unplucked bud and, every now and then I surprise myself at my own poetry, the wide open flower.
I don't know why she sent that, said the chief. It's immaterial to our discussion. Ho ho!
The laugh was booming, like one of the Santas who were already showing up in the department stores.
You don't have to say anything else, Jocko, because with this picture, and what a picture it is, you have saved yourself 1,000 words, and now I am truly sorry. I simply cannot do it, not even for 10,000 words.
Well, there's more. There's plenty more that I...
Abdul, what are you looking at? Keep working. There, keep at it. That's the spot.
Look, I won't pretend that I didn't think a girl like this might be good for business. It crossed my mind. But I swear that's not why I'm begging for this favor. It's because of family feeling. The Warner Brothers family. The girl is in danger. She knows too much.
You're not making sense, Jacko. Too much about what?
I don't know myself. I'm not sure. There's this letter, where she says how much she wants to come, and how frightened she is because she knows some secret about that Führer guy, and that other women have died because of it, and then, this is the funny part, the part I don't get, she says there's another secret, something about the fleet. She means the Japanese fleet is going to sail, and there's going to be an attack on a Sunday, and somewhere here, let's see, yeah, right here. Submarines are already on their way, and...
Here the president gave another big laugh. I could feel it under my fingers.
Ho-ho, now I understand. You want her to be in one of your pictures. Some big battle at sea. Is she going to be a nurse? In love with a sailor? And you want the cooperation of the Navy, eh?
No, no. I mean, yes. We'd love to work with the Navy, but listen. This isn't a picture. I mean, wait a second. Here are her actual words.
With that, the chief put his finger down on the paper.
Let's see. Oh, yeah. You must tell the president about Pearl Harbor and Admiral Yamamoto and Operation Z.
Yamamoto? Is that the guy Laurie plays over at Fox?
The president had pushed himself up with both hands. He turned to the Navy guy.
Lieutenant Fox?
Now his whole body, except for his legs, was raised off the table. Will you immediately escort Abdul and Mr. Prettyman outside? I never heard that tone of voice from Mr. FDR. The Navy officer took hold of my arm with one hand, and with the other took hold of Prettyman. He marched us out of the room. When he turned to go back in, the president said,
No, you too, Lieutenant. I want you to leave me alone with my Hollywood friend. Ha ha ha, the things they think up in that town. Ha ha ha, submarines.
The next thing I knew, Mr. Prettyman and the terrible Turk were out in the corridor, and the Navy man was standing with his two legs apart and his hands on his hips outside the door. On one of those hips was a gun. How long did we wait out there? It seemed a long time, but in reality it was only a half an hour, tops. At first, we could not hear anything. Not a word and not a sound. But after a while, there were voices. And also a clank, a bang, a burst of laughter. Then came more clanking and something that sounded like maybe a waiter had dropped a pile of tin plates. After that, it became quiet again. But it was only the quiet in front of the storm, because all of a sudden the door flew open and the lieutenant jumped to one side, and out came first Jack and then the president. He was wearing only the glasses on his nose and the steel on his legs, and he was walking, one foot and then the other, working his shoulders, swinging his arms, and wouldn't let Jack or me or the colored touch him. He just kept walking and at the same time shouting,
by God, Abdul, you've done it this time. You're a wonder, a miracle worker, a treasure. You have brought a dead man back to life.
4. Aboard the Europa. Goebbels, first day of May 1945, Berlin.
The end must now be measured in days, not in hours. Yet some still cling to fantasies. There has been talk of the twilight of the gods. Did not monsters in that age storm the citadel, even as they do today in ours? Flames devoured it. The sacred walls crumbled. All seemed lost. Ah, suddenly a new Valhalla arises, more splendorous than ever before. Thus, at the close of my life, I am surrounded by children. Against all odds, Frederick the Great was victorious at Leuthen. And so it follows in their syllogism, we shall be victorious in Berlin. Yet even these prattling babes fall silent when the ground shakes over our heads. Nothing can be heard but the hum of the ventilator fans. Basso continuo, by Wagner. The question is not, have our enemies won, but how long shall their victory last? That will be determined by the example we set here in our final refuge. The Führer, in declining to flee, has done his part. By dying with honor ourselves, with some part of the Führer's heroism, we create the legend that will break the chains that bind the Bolshevized continent. The myth of our perishing will make certain that National Socialism, the true citadel of our time, will rise again, not just in Germany or Europe, but in America itself. As for the Jews, they will meet their canai not in centuries, but sooner than they, in their dancing and Purim merriment, could ever believe.
Fräulein Kaufmann, March 1937, Berlin.
My dear, dear Uncle Engel came by today. Even though he is a film star and a film producer, he wears the same old suit and scuffed-up shoes. And he said he wants me to be in a movie, in a lot of movies. I had to cry for an hour to get Hannelore to agree. Tonight she will put my hair in braids. Already I am staring into the mirror.
Goebbels, May 1937, Berlin.
I spend the afternoon preparing my radio broadcast. Then to the Chancellery to watch a film with the Führer. It features Zara Leander, who I feel is overestimated. She has the typical pinched features and limited range one finds in a representative of a small state. At the UFA reception, I asked her whether Zara was a Jewish name. She has no humor. She said, just like the name Josef. I would not want to be a Swede, only a member of a world power. But in that film, a brief scene with a golden-haired child, perhaps 15, in the Australian work camp. Charming in her braids.
June 1937, Berlin.
I see that Mädchen again, once more in an Engelsing production, Andere Welt. She wanders down an obviously fake Oriental street, wearing the hat of a coolie. The hair is dyed jet black and pulled back. But the eyes, they cannot be disguised, even in black and white and Aryan blue. A smile. One tooth overlaps another. Must contact Lenich to discover her name.
August 1937, Berlin.
Uncut version of Die Umwege des schönen Karl. An empty comedy. That girl again. In a beach costume. Running in and running out of the waves. The swimsuit is in two pieces, which is becoming more common. We Germans are not prudes. I have asked the Reichsfilmkammer to give me her name. The idiots have not been able to perform this simple task. We might have to replace Lenich sometime soon. The cameraman shows us the touching adolescent shoulders, the legs, der niedliches kleines Arsch.
October 1937, Berlin.
I now watch each Tobis film with special attention, and my efforts are rewarded. Today, at a private screening, I see her sitting with her protector, Engelsing, at a cafe table. Smoke, music, a laughing crowd. She has her natural blonde hair, but with an ugly smear of lipstick across her lips. Ah, when she smiles, there is that one tooth overlapping the other. The long swan's curve of the neck,
Engelsing is under watch. Many dubious contacts. Twice observed at the entrance to Soviet embassy. But our child is growing into a woman.
Fräulein Kaufmann, October 1937, Berlin.
I am going to India, and by myself. I mean, with Uncle Engel and all the actors and all the crew and the makeup man, but not Hannelore. She said the strangest thing. If I go, I don't come back. You should not come back either. But of course I am going to come back. She doesn't believe in the new Germany. She even says bad things about our Führer, who is working so hard for his people. Because we had to move from our flat. Because she doesn't work in the auction house. Because I can't go to school. Well, an actress doesn't have to go sit in a boring old classroom. And Uncle Engel said I am beautiful enough to be an actress. Only he does not want me to call him Uncle Engel anymore, but just plain Alex. And now I am going to have lines to read and an actual close-up. Why should I sit in the stupid old Hörer Schule, where all they can do is read about India and the Taj Mahal? But I'm going to see everything for myself. I'll come and give them a lecture about the temple dancers and the people who swim in the Ganges River and the tiger hunt. Now I must put to memory my lines. When Herr Theo, dear old Herr Theo, asks me where the Maharaja is, I am going to say that I am not allowed to tell that to the Sahib. Sahib! Sahib! And of course I have to dye my blonde hair black. I practiced it last night, and Hallelora, well, I thought she was going to slap me. She lifted her hand, but instead turned away and said, "Now you look like a verdrecht Jude." I don't care. I don't care if I look like a Jew or a gypsy or a kangaroo. I am going to India. And next year I will get a bigger part, and we will have lots of money, and no one will be able to say anything or do anything when I am a famous star. Of course, I will have to change my name. I think I should also change my teeth.
Goebbels, December 1937, Berlin.
This morning, at last, I find on my desk the dossier of the young Tobias actress, not from the Inkompetenten at the Reichsfilmkammer, but from the SS. Strange the workings of destiny. That this young actress should turn out to be the daughter of that same Kaufmann who shot himself in the Gloria-Palast 4 years ago. 20 million sweethearts. Ein Musikkomödie von Warner First National. All I had to do was raise my hat. Twice. Then our good German folk expressed their indignation. Who would have guessed that our attractive matron with her noble brow and that Kussmund was a Jewess? Well, if we have temporarily permitted Furtwängler to keep his hooked-nosed violinists, like gypsies, they have an affinity for that instrument, then we at the Reichsfilmkammer can allow this young girl to play her parts, especially since the bereaved widow has already resumed her matron name of Kaiser, which her daughter has wisely adopted as well.
April 1938, Berlin.
Tageskopie of Der Tiger von Eschnapur arrived this afternoon. For the first time we hear her voice. Theo Lingen, the comedian, strolls through a palace courtyard. He comes across a veiled servant with a basket of fruit on her head. "Wo ist der Maharaja?" he asks her. "I'm not allowed to tell that to the Sahib." Those are Fräulein Kaiser's first spoken words. Here is what happens next. Lingen takes the fruit and peels away the veil. A close-up. The large, wide-spaced eyes. The cheekbones full enough to cast shadows. The thin upper lip and the pouting lower one. I know this face well. The actor, however, has never seen such a sight in his life. As the girl moves shyly away, he stands, thunderstruck. She would be a good start for my harem. What is Engelsing up to? On the one hand, he gives his protégé some lines to speak, and he takes her all the way to India to deliver them. At the same time, he hides her away in these frivolous diversions for the masses. I intend to do something about that. It is time for me to turn this beautiful young girl into an actress.
Fräulein Kaiser, May 1938, Berlin.
People think Alex and I began our, what to call it, our love story when we were in India. But the truth is, it did not begin until we were on the steamboat for the long, long, long trip back. Together. Always together. With the light streaming through the round steamship window. How on earth all the world found out about it, I don't know. There they were, waiting for us when we docked at Hamburg. The flash lamps, the reporters with their pencils, and radio people with the microphones in our faces. And I only had a few lines. But of course, my close-up. Is this what it will be like to be a star? When did you fall in love, Fräulein? Was it at the Taj Mahal? I did not tell them the truth. I did not tell Alex the truth, which is that my feeling for him began long before the Europa. He does not remember, but I do. How he used to throw me in the air, up to the ceiling where I would almost hit my head, and Jojo would catch me. Then Jojo would throw me, and my uncle, my Engel, would catch me, the two of them laughing and I shrieking and pretending to be afraid. I really was afraid. But I could smell him then, the sweat of him. It is the smell exactly that he still has now. He is planning a new part for me. In our next film, he is going to hold me, embrace me, and we are going to kiss.
Goebbels, June 1940, Berlin. Definite news of the ceasefire at Compiègne. Spent the night with Magda and a small circle of fellow workers at Lanka. The silvery waters, the silvery light, champagne. I announced that, in my opinion, the war is over. Britain without France cannot fight on. Our unit filmed the ceremony. The Führer accepted the surrender in the same railway carriage in which Foch humiliated us in 1918. Great and glorious Germany. Over the last 18 months, I have permitted the Kaufmann girl, Fräulein Kaiser, to appear in three films, each time with englishing. The newspapers cannot get enough of it. The Opa Romanza, they call it, because they are living together off-screen as well as on. I only wish he were old enough to be her grandfather. His blood may be pure, but in our investigation of his ancestry, we uncovered his ties to the Soviets. This uncle is quite likely a spy. Now he wants to take her off to film an epic in Poland. We shall see about that. On this happy day, I have seen the fall of France and shall begin to truly shape this Fräulein's career, a career that began with a single moment. If I had blinked, I would have missed that golden-haired child. But I never blink. Last day of May, 1945, Berlin. A tap at the door. Tap-tapping. The children have come to say good night. I force myself to look at them. What pleasure they have brought me over these years. If I am honest with myself, I would say the only pleasure. The fall of France? Nothing. Everything. The girls following Helmut, all in a row on their ponies. Now Hilda comes running in her nightgown and stockings. My God. With ribbons in her hair. Are you coming up to say good night, Papa? No, not just now. You see, I have work to do. Helmut, is it your diaries? Is what you are writing? Oh, I've put those Tagebücher away. But I thought I would be able to read them. Yes, yes, someday you will. Here's a promise, my smart boy. I'll show you a page in the morning. Me too? This is Heide. What, are you reading now? And only four? But I will be five the same day as you. Aren't I lucky? We shall have a big cake together. Just the two of us. Hedda breaks in. That isn't fair. But don't you get a big cake just for yourself on your birthday? She puts a finger to her chin, thinking this over. I'll tell you what, my Liebsten. We won't wait for a birthday. Tomorrow we shall have cake for everyone. What a garland of smiles. What joy. As if they were already tucking their napkins around their necks.
I have no choice but to turn away and say more sternly than I wished, "To bed now. Mama is waiting. Don't make me count to 10. You know what happens when I do." They all move backward. They all go out. Alone for the moment, I attempt to look with objectivity at myself. What am I feeling? Disgust. In spite of everything, a life of heroic effort, of sacrifice, 100,000 arms thrust upward, 100,000 voices, totaler Krieg. I am no different than anyone else. In the end, we are all good burghers, with our slippers and newspapers and a pretty child to bring our pipe. And let's have a cheery fire, too. Ponies. A ribbon in the hair.
Fräulein Kaiser, December 1940, Berlin.
The press follows us day and night. This morning they were waiting outside the door of our flat. What about your next film? The reporters hound mein Engel with their questions. Will Karolina play your mistress? Will you carry her away in your arms? Alex only tells them that sometime next year our new film will be shot in Poland, and that its name will be Heimke. He says that it will show how our people were persecuted there and why Germany had to invade that land in order to save them. Later, once they have gone, he says to me to pay no attention and that it is only more propaganda. But he has a secret plan. He really does want to carry me away. Not to Poland, but onward, to the east, over the border to the Soviet Union. He says there we will be safe. There we can make true films. There we can be true artists. Can that be? I don't know. I don't care. I will follow him anywhere.
Goebbels, first day of May 1945, Berlin.
Where is Stumpfegger? Has he not found the cigarettes? Or is he smoking them himself? He has a more precious treasure. Rarer than the golden party badge that the Führer gave Magda.
A gift for the children, a priceless gift, though not one of them is having a birthday.
Oh, for a cigarette!
5. A Bulgarian. The Terrible Turk, April 1942, Burbank.
We all followed the chief, or maybe now I should call him the colonel, from the wardrobe department and outdoors. It was a nice spring day in the valley, a blue sky, with what in Anatolia we call horsetail clouds. The chief, as soon as he got outside, put his hand to the visor of his cap and stared up at the sky. It was a habit he had developed, not to look at the clouds, but for the bombers and fighters of the Japs. We were right in line with the aircraft plants in Burbank, which is why he had set the painters splash a big sign with an arrow on top of one of the sound stages, Lockheed, that-a-way. Anyhow, who should come past the guardhouse of the main gate but Julius J. Epstein and his brother Phil? This, for the chief, was worse than a flight of zeros. He stopped short. So did the twins. They looked at Mr. Warner. Then they looked at each other. Their two bald heads turned pink, like eggs you color at Easter. Instead of doubling up in laughter, they did the opposite. I mean, they stood up so straight they were bending backward, and, as if they had rehearsed it, saluted. Then they saluted again and were about to do it for the third time when the chief, his arms were already down at his side and twitching as if he were holding an invisible whip, said, all right, knock it off. The boys, which is what everybody called them, simultaneously said, yes, sir, colonel, sir. Lieutenant colonel, goddammit. Was that a snort from Miss Kaiser just behind me, or was it a laugh? No doubt about the two writers. They were struggling to hold it in. One or the other of them, no telling which pea in the pod, said, hi there, Hadassah. Very funny, said the chief. By now, everybody in Burbank knew the story. One of the boys had stolen a piece of stationery from the chief's office and got a gopher to hand her a letter practically the first minute she stepped foot on the lot. Date, December 10th, 1941. Subject, screen name, to Karolina Kaiser, from
from Jack L. Warner. Dear Miss Kaiser, this is just a brief note to welcome you into the Warner Brothers family. My brothers and I look forward to a long and fruitful association with you under your new name, Hadassah Felberbaum. Regards to your mother in the old country, Jack L. Warner. Please call me Jack. They copied his signature right down to the loop on top of the J and the slash mark underneath it. The story is that back then, in December, the chief came running up and grabbed the letter out of her hand. Forget about this, he told her. I know the wise guys who pulled this prank. I've already got a screen name for you. From now on, you're Cheryl Charmaine. That's what I call class. Class or no class, none of us knew that name would only last a couple of weeks. Now J.L. turned to the writers and said, I knew it was you two jokers. To head off trouble, I called to one of the twins. Say, Julie, when are we going to have that fight? 5 rounds. The terrible Turk is going to take on both of you at once. It's all for war bonds. Buy them and hold them. Okay, we'll do it. But one at a time. No, that wouldn't be fair to you. You never had a professional fight. Not true, said Julius J. I had one. It ended in a draw. Then how come you never had another? His brother chimed in. He wanted to retire.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.